and had been surrounding him for a long time. Let's put it like that.
People who went to see that movie, they thought that he was the worst person in the world.
He was just hurt within himself that he couldn't get through this. And he'd rather just go ahead and just tear himself up by getting high.
He had a heart, you know? He wasn't what people had made him out to be.
His character was so destroyed. I think he just died of heartbreak.
Born in 1931, Ike Turner was never a stranger to trouble or hard times. His mother was a seamstress, his father a Baptist minister. He grew up on the outskirts of Clarksdale, Mississippi, where poverty and segregation came with the territory.
That was quite a bit of a divide at that time. It was a little tough. There was a lot of, you know, prejudice.
The protection, you know, that law is supposed to give to people, you know, that was non-existent in those days.
When Ike was 5 years old, he watched as his father was savagely beaten by a local posse for having an affair with a white woman.
He was actually in the front window watching these men do this to his father. You know what I'm saying? That is traumatic enough. And then seeing that and not being able to do anything about it.
The hospitals during the time wouldn't even allow him to go to be treated.
They had to prepare a tent in the backyard. And him and my mom would have to go out and take things to his dad. And they say you could smell it for miles around because his intestines was completely beaten out.
His father ultimately died from his injuries.
You know, something like that at a young age, you know, you don't ever erase.
With his father gone, Ike was frequently abused sexually by older women, beginning at the age of 6.
By the time he was 12 years old, he had been molested by 3 older women. Yes, and you know, it was rape. These women forced themselves upon him as a kid.
No one looked at it in that terms of degree, but it probably gave him a lower esteem as far as dealing with women.
But growing up in Clarksdale, Ike found his calling as well. The town was a mecca for blues and home base for such legends as Robert Johnson, Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, and pianist Pine Top Perkins.
Pine Top played a lot at a pool hall, and Ike had a job at the pool hall sweeping up. And Pine Top said if Ike ran errands for him, he would teach Ike how to play.
By his teen years, Ike was spinning records at local radio station WROX and developing his musical chops on piano and guitar.
Ike, not only did he DJ here, but the Ike Turner Orchestra played at certain times during the day or during the week, whenever.
We put our band together, and I named it the Kings of Rhythm. Whatever would get hot on the jukebox, that's what we would play. When we started playing, the people would applaud because we sound just like the jukebox, you know?
Ike had a very different explosive sound because within his blues, you had like a jazz flavor. And then, on top of that, he had a rock edge.
Ike's sound caught the ear of B.B. King, who had his own radio show up the road in Memphis. That led to a recording date in 1951 with Sam Phillips at Memphis's Sun Studios, and a song Ike wrote about a hot car called Rocket 88.
You women have heard of jalopies, you've heard the noise they make, but let me introduce my new Rocket 88. Yes, it's straight, just one way. Everybody likes my Rocket 88.
Distorted guitar, the piano part that I play, and you know, the sax solo and all those things, many people consider that to be the first rock and roll song.
That was a disc jockey, Dewey Phillips. And when he played it on his radio show, all of the white kids returned to the record shop to buy it. That's when they found out that white kids would buy black music.
Rocket 88 hit number one on the charts, stayed there for 5 weeks, and became a classic that Ike would proudly perform 5 decades later.
When I hear Rocket 88, I think of a transition between Delta blues and rock and roll. It's a landmark, actually, this song.
You may want to call it rock and roll, but I call it boogie woogie. But you know, they can call it what they want to call it. I'd just be playing what I play.
But there was a catch. Because Ike's saxophonist Jackie Brinston sang the lead vocal, he got the song credit. And Ike Turner got a check for $20.
The numbers on this was probably at that time astronomical as far as what it was actually producing. But to get $20?
That helped him to understand why it's called show business. After that happened, he was determined that no one would ever take anything from him again.
Through the early 50s, Ike worked as a record producer and session musician on records like B.B. King's